So let's start with dark matter, okay? What is this elusive thing, and why do you think it exists?
So we're particle physicists, and the basic type of question that we're interested in asking is, what are we made of? What is the universe comprised of? What are the basic fundamental building blocks that everything from which everything else emerges? And we have a beautiful mathematical theory that describes almost perfectly almost everything that we've observed in nature, and that's called the Standard Model of Particle Physics. But we know that this beautiful theory, which is very elegant and has withstood nearly 40 years of experimental scrutiny, can't be the final answer of nature, because it leaves certain questions that are unanswered. And maybe one of the biggest of those questions is this issue of dark matter. What is dark matter?
All right, so what is dark matter? Basically what we do is we look up in the sky and we notice that there's a lot out there that we can't see. There's more than we can see. And actually, almost the entire universe is dark. It's made up of things that we can't see. About 3/4 is something called dark energy, but roughly 1/4 of the total energy in the dark matter, the total energy in the universe is made up of dark matter. And how do we know this? Well, we look up in the stars, in the sky, in dust, and we count, and we just observe how much dust and how much stars there is. And then from this, from the stars and the dust, we can calculate the gravitational force that all these objects are exerting. And you see that there's some reason there's more gravity acting on the stars and the dust than the stars and the dust can account for. So we know there has to be something out there exerting gravity that we can't see. And this is the stuff we call dark matter. And actually there's 5 times more of this dark matter than the stuff that we can see. And this is one of the biggest mysteries of the universe right now, is what is this dark matter? What is this stuff that we can't see?
So just to sort of give you a picture of this, what it means is that if the mass of the dark matter is something like the mass of the proton, then there's roughly one dark matter particle in your cup of coffee. Okay, so it's here all the time around us, but we can't see it. We know that it's there, but it doesn't interact with light. We can't see it, and we want to know what that is. So we've been trying to detect this these dark matter particles, but because they interact very, very weakly, it's really a very tough job. And we've been trying to do that in sort of 3 different ways, I'd say. So one way is what we call is colliders, where the idea is that we take particles that we know and love, such as electrons or protons, and we smash them on each other, and we hope to produce dark matter particles that somehow we'll be able to detect in our detectors. So that's, for instance, what we do with the Large Hadron Collider in CERN. We search for them also with targets sitting deep underground in the lab, where we take some big pool, some tank of something, not filled with water, but with some heavy nuclei, and we hope to have dark matter come and scatter off of that and leave some imprints in our detector. And we also search via telescopes, where we look into the sky and we hope to see sort of regular particles like photons or electrons or positrons that could be the result of some dark matter that had decayed or annihilated up in the sky. So we've been searching in these different ways, but it's very tricky, and we haven't yet been able to find these particles.
So what is your proposal on dark matter research? How do you think that we can detect this dark matter?
Why don't you answer this first?
So I'd say that the story is basically the following. For the last 40 years, there's been one dark matter notion, one sort of dark matter, let me call it a candidate for dark matter, that's really been captivating the attention of theorists and experimentalists alike. And it's called the weakly interacting massive particle, or in short, people gave it a catchy name, it's called the WIMP. And this particle is some dark matter particle that interacts very weakly with ordinary matter. And the mass of this dark matter particle is roughly around, let's say, 100 times the mass of the proton. And this is a really beautiful dark matter candidate. It naturally occurs in many different theories of particle physics. And it's really captivated the attention of both theorists and experimentalists. And because this has been the dominant idea for dark matter for 4 decades, it's also influenced and guided the way that we've designed experimental searches.
So I'd say, these 3 types of way of looking for dark matter, we design experiments specifically to look for the WIMP.
And so a lot of the type of research that, we do is thinking, and I think in general the particle physics community is sort of recognizing that thinking of one type of idea for so many years was great, and if you were going to choose one idea to think of for 40 years, this was the great one to do. But maybe we need to sort of broaden the searchlight and think a little bit about the bigger picture, because dark matter could be, there are roughly 80 orders of magnitude in terms of what its mass could be. Okay, dark matter could be many, 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 many orders of magnitude higher, or many, 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 many orders of magnitude lower in mass than what's been considered for the WEN. Mm-hmm. And so our research has been focused on thinking of these new ideas for dark matter that is not the WIMP. In particular, there's been a lot of activity on thinking about dark matter that's substantially lighter than the WIMP. So for instance, and you can already see why it's really important to think about these things, because if dark matter is 1,000 times lighter than the WIMP, so instead of 100 times the mass of a proton, if it's 1/10 the mass of a proton, then these types of targets that we've designed, they're just not sensitive to this. So dark matter could be there, and we haven't seen it because the experiment we designed wasn't sensitive.
And so, I mean, one such model that we proposed for what dark matter can be is a strongly interacting massive particle, which we call the SIMP, not a weakly interacting massive particle, but strongly interacting massive particle, a particle that interacts strongly with itself. And if you calculate the mass of this dark matter, you'd find that indeed it's roughly 1,000 times less than the mass of a WIMP. And so this type of dark matter candidate, which is just as reasonable as a WIMP, it's not being searched for, right? These experiments were designed to look for a WIMP, but it could very well be that the dark matter is something else, like a SIMP, and we just haven't designed an experiment to look for it. And so...
So we've also been, so together with, as a particle physics phenomenologist, we're interested, so we're theorists, but we always work in close contact with experiment. So on the one hand, we, in the context of dark matter, we think of new theories for its particle identity. And for instance, this SIMP idea is one such example, and it predicts that you'd have a dark matter particle that is 1,000 times lighter than what's been searched for so far. But at the same time, we also want to think of new experimental techniques to search for this. And so, for instance, we've also proposed, so again, if you think of this billiard ball picture, so as we said, if I'm looking for a WIMP for very heavy dark matter, it makes sense that dark matter would come in and scatter off of, hit this big heavy atom, no problem for it to give it a kick, and we can detect that. But if dark matter is 1,000 times lighter, such as the case for the SIMP and for many other new dark matter ideas that have been emerging in recent times, then the kinematics is more like this tiny little ping pong ball that's trying to give this kick to the big bowling ball. It's just not going to work. And so you actually, in that case, when you have lighter dark matter, you want to scatter off of something that's lighter, just because you can punch it around much more efficiently. And with this realization that maybe if you want light dark matter, you should scatter off of electrons, there are many new systems that have been proposed by theorists together with experimentalists. So you can think of looking for these things in superconductors. You can think of looking in them, looking at semiconductors, looking at scintillators, looking at particles, at electrons that get ejected from graphene. These are all types of ideas that have been that we've been working on, and the community has been working on really new experimental proposals for how you could search for lighter dark matter. And the experimental community is also picking up on these, and sort of hand in hand, these things are now being brought into research and development stages, so that these experiments will actually be built and we'll be able to detect light dark matter if it's there.
Right. So it's a very exciting time, because for the first time in a long time, we're looking for a new type of dark matter. So in the coming years, we'll finally be sensitive to looking for other types of dark matter that's not a WIMP, and it's very exciting that possibly in the next 10 years or so, we can make a discovery of dark matter.
Okay, so we can't avoid the fact that your guys are married. How it is to work together at the same field or the same place? Are you working together all the time? You have different projects?
Well, obviously it's great to work together since we're doing it. And so we work a lot together. Of course, we also don't work something different. Like, we do work together, but we do work separately.
But you manage your time together, I don't know.
Well, I'd say in general, the field of particle physics phenomenology is an extremely collaborative field. So, at any given point in time, we have multiple projects with multiple collaborators, all across the world. And some of those projects, you know, some of those projects we are collaborators, and other projects we're collaborating with other people. And so,
yeah,
we're all
so
into
the... found a good collaborator. And I guess that's
one.
I guess it's great because I can ask someone silly questions without being embarrassed.
Okay,
like,
you have like, you
like,
know,
it's
great to have
these. Yeah. maybe you can tell the audience a little bit how did you guys met and why did you decide to work here?
Well, actually, we first met, I think, just like one building down from here, so probably less than 100 meters from where we're sitting. So we first met maybe around 8 years ago, something like that, for the first time, when we were both students in graduate school.
I was here for the school at the Institute for Advanced Studies for winter school, and we met there.
Right.
I guess we can speak again for a few years, but I came back to Israel to do a postdoc at Tel Aviv University. I did a postdoc in Israel because physics in Israel is really great. High energy physics is really strong here.
So we always knew that we wanted to come back to Israel after we both did postdocs in the US. And as I've said, I mean, science in Israel is amazing. Physics in Israel is amazing. High energy physics in Israel is amazing. And we love the university. They're really amazing, amazing students. And you know, we just love everything about it. Beautiful campus. So we're really happy to be able to come here.
And we're excited to come here together so we can build a group of high energy phenomenology, kind of like in our image, we have a philosophy of what our group should be like, should be fun and active and kind of just fun. I mean, that's what I mean. It's
good physics and good spirits.
Yes,
yeah.
Exactly.
Okay, in your opinion, how physics will be 20 years from now, maybe you can tell us what is your vision and how do you fit in this vision?
Well, I not say I hope it's nothing like what I expect, right? Because that's really the fun about doing fundamental physics is that we'll be asking new questions, questions I can't even think of. We'll make discoveries I can't imagine.
So hopefully, you know, some of the open questions that we have today will be answered. And as Eric said, it's the most exciting if they're answered in some way that we haven't even thought of. You know, nature is most likely to be even more spectacular.
So you hope dark matter exists or not?
Oh, of course.
Yeah.
But we have no idea, you know, we have no idea what it is. And I think really the driving force behind, you know, basic science in general, definitely for fundamental physics, is just this really, just this pure curiosity about nature. And we just want to know, you know, what is it? What is out there? What is everything made of? And however, you know, whatever the answer is to that, we certainly can't predict. We hope to be, you know, to be around when we find out some answers to some of these questions, and hopefully that just sparks new questions that we can continue exploring for the time after that.
I mean, it would be really exciting if it was one of our theories, but it would just be thrilling nonetheless if we learn the nature of dark matter.
Okay, you need Derek, thank you.
Thanks.